Pastor Ayodeji Kurumi is an investment banker and partner at Enzo Crypton & Company, a management consulting firm that offers financial advisory and human capital services in Nigeria and across the globe. In addition to advising custodians of offshore capital seeking for investment opportunities across Africa, Enzo Crypton & Company also focuses on helping business leaders solve difficult problems, achieve sustainable growth, and continually create marketable value in a rapidly changing business environment. A graduate of Obafemi Awolowo University, Ayodeji Kurumi possesses industry experience as a shared services specialist in financial technology products and designing of special purpose platforms for consummation of electronic transactions and inter-party settlements. He conceptualized and managed the development of the first real-time settlement system for electronic transactions initiated by microfinance clients on third-party channels in Africa. He has also led financial advisory teams and helped close over $200 million in fundraising and mergers and acquisition deals for SMEs and private equity. His wife, Pastor Debola Deji Kurumi, is a transformational catalyst and the founder of Immerse Coaching Company, a personal transformation coaching practice. She is also the executive director at Ideation Hub Africa, a public policy and impact advisory firm, and the president at Kingdom Women Global Alliance and the Firebrand Movement, both of which are faith-based organizations. She is a Thomas International Certified Workplace Personality Profile Analyst, Certified Job Evaluation Analyst, and an experienced corporate trainer. She is also a Certified Visionary Leadership Coach by the Ole Kanovalov Global Coaching Certification. Debola Deji Kurumi has received several recognitions and awards for her outstanding leadership impact. In 2014, she was awarded New Leader for Tomorrow in the Order of Business, Government and Parliament at the Crans Montana Forum in Geneva. In 2018, she was selected by the U.S. government as one of Africa's most promising young leaders. In 2019, she was listed as one of 100 most inspiring Nigerian women and announced as Nigeria's leading coach at the 2021 Motherland Awards. She also served twice as a mentor jury of the Queen's Young Leader Awards, a UK government fellowship that honors exceptional young leaders in the Commonwealth. DDK is the author of 20 books, including the classic titled Firebrand. PDK and DDK are both resident pastors at the Baptizing Church Lekki, and they are blessed with beautiful children. Ladies and gentlemen, meet our first couple on the show, PDK and DDK.
Go.
Okay. If I could change one thing in the world, it would be the leadership of the African state. If I could change something in the world, it would really be around a new generation of ethical, principled, value-based leaders emerging in all the communities, countries on the continent of Africa. And that's a big goal that I've set myself toward in the work that I do.
You know, so the thing is, what she has said just now is really at the heart of anything that I would change as well. You know, my mind was really going to, you know, when the question was asked, my thought was really going to things that were sort of borderline globally controversial, right? And I was wondering how do I structure it? But I think this is a very good way to structure. It's really at the heart of a lot of things that I also teach, and that is to change the narrative in terms of African leadership. There's too much potential, you know, across the continent, and Nigeria, Africa. The problem is a crisis of leadership.
Yeah.
It's as simple as that.
What are Ituran Firebrands? My brain says, do this, and they go right ahead and they do it. They are not counselors. We have two types of muscles. These muscles are not under voluntary control. Fibroids generally, they are benign tumors. That is, they are not cancerous. The brain finds a way to control them to do what they have to do, but you can't mentally, consciously control them. When these muscles now develop and grow more than they should, then we say that person has a leiomyoma. That's a fibroid. Don't mind that big English. It's just what we call uterine fibroid.
Okay, so the first thing is, I don't know what people are saying. I don't care about it. And by nature and wiring, I'm not one to, and I feel it's almost the same my husband. Yeah, I can say that for both of us by wiring. We really don't live for the stereotypes. We really don't live for the labels. I believe my husband is even less in touch with what anybody might think, or, you know. So to just, for a foundation, by nature, I don't think that we've ever built any part of our lives with reference to the thoughts, the perspectives, the expectations of society, to be honest. So I don't have a sense of what might be in the minds of people about us, you know. But to speak to how we find that balance in terms of the work we do and what places one person in public eye, etc. I think my husband met me already towing the path that I'm on. And I'm so grateful about that, because I find that some of the struggles that people face in their marriages, especially visionary women, is sometimes connected to what I call the evolution gap. They were married at this level, and then they really start to catch on to powerful insights and vision and all of that. And they're growing and changing, and maybe not even navigating those changes so well, to the point that their husbands are feeling like, you're really changing, you know, what in coil or whatever. My husband met me on the path of doing ministry. He would even sometimes drop me at events when we're cutting, where I would go to speak, or, you know, come pick me after a meeting and then ask me how everything went. Would give me ideas and, you know, share the word with me before sessions. So I feel like that was an important foundation. We were clear on what path that we sensed the Lord was leading us. I had a strong picture in my heart about who I believed he was and what the Lord had said to me about him. He has the same or had the same. So because I, you know, when we were cutting, I was already on the path of really being in the front line because of the kind of assignment the Lord had put in my hands, you know, and him always saying that you are, you know, the world might see you as this person, but you're my baby, you're my girl. I want to cover you, I want to mentor you. Do you see? So I don't think he really ever sees me as that person, like that DDK, that whoever that DDK is. He really sees me as Debola, this person that he wants to, and he read me, there's too much to say, like, he read a whole manifesto to me when we were courting about the kind of woman I was going to become if I married him, do you see? So underneath even who I've become is his investment that I want to nurture into a powerful woman, do you see? So whatever anybody is seeing on the outside, is all part of the game plan that the guy came with from the beginning, that I want to see you thrive, I want to see you shine, I want to see you do well, and everything that, you know, it will take to make that happen. I'm here to supply. That's the first. The second is, my generation has to separate popularity. They've got to separate popularity from profundity, from power, do you see? Having a large following is not the only measure of being powerful in your space, of making a difference, of thought leadership, do you see? So that Deji Kumbi doesn't play the social media game doesn't make him any less powerful, do you see? And if you're following his organization, Enzo Crypting, you may get a sense of the degree of thought leadership that is going into that consulting practice. So between the both of us, I'm the one who's even constantly astonished by his brilliance. Do you see? So there isn't a case of, maybe I'm more popular. So no. Between the both of us, I'm the one who feels like I'm constantly awestruck by greatness. Like, this guy is too brilliant. So we are on the path of destiny, serving the work the Lord has put in our hands, and we're thriving at it. Mine has a requirement to leverage media significantly because I've been called to raise a generation and to build an army, and I have to be on that path with them. But the caliber of work that is getting done on both sides is, to the glory of God, commendable. And between both of us, I feel like we have a reason. Yeah, we have a reason that I love and I'm thankful for.
I'll try. Most of my relaxing is private, in the sense that I just need to relax mentally. And I think a lot of times I turn to two things. It's either I'm playing chess or I'm watching comedy, you know. So those are two things that sort of relaxes me mentally. I think those two, and then of course, you've heard the other one, which is just being with my wife, Justine, and it's always a wonderful time. We get to just catch up on each other and laugh a lot, share private jokes, mm-hmm. and it's always very relaxing. I mean, be the boring type, because I kind of enjoy the company of people, sort of, but I don't go out to.
No.
Yeah, I don't deliberately engage. You know, in terms of, you know, there are some people like that. Hello, Alpha, let's catch up. Hello, let's catch up. And then they bandy somewhere. You know, anytime I'm thinking about going out, I'm just thinking about going out with my wife. Really. My mind doesn't stray, even to friends. So yeah, that's it for me, yeah.
I have structured relaxation. I love it. I protect it with all my chest. I invest in it. So primarily, I love to step away from my home to a hotel. I love staycations in hotels. I try to do it every quarter. And it's the time that I think there's something like spiritual relaxation, because it's also the time where I just retreat, drink into God's presence, really listen for what He has to say to me, and rest, watch movies, be quiet. I need solitude to be relaxed. I need to be alone. I need to be away. Even if I can't be away all the time, I do need to be alone, right? So yeah, I use those staycations, private retreats, stepping out of my home for relaxation. I also sort of set up my different parts of my home in a way that allows me to get into particular types of moods. Yes, so if I get into my study, there's a way that it can make me feel, especially if my children are out of the home or they're in bed. And there's a way I get into what I call like a creative flow zone, which has a good impact on my mind and how my body feels afterward. So yeah, my staycations are important. I take my Mondays out. No work Mondays are no work for me. Rest and retreat, renewal. I also relax by hanging out with my children. I'm really goofy with them. We dance and jump on each other and wear rock sometimes. I enjoy that. I love getting into our bedroom at night to gist my husband. I can be grumpy on the days that I can't have that. I'm just like, what are you doing? What is, like, can I break this laptop? Because I can't explain it in words. There's a way that it almost releases a type of hormone that nothing else, I don't know how to describe it, but there's a way it makes my soul, it's almost like a soul spark. when we're just gisting, watching something together, laughing, being intimate, there's something that he does and nothing else does for me, you know. Yeah. So, and then I am now better with catching up with friends. I have lunch dates with friends now, and I'm happy about it. Seriously, with this question, I was deliberating with my husband, like, what do I really share? Primarily because, to be honest, I operate a degree of emotional agility. And it's important to just say that as well for everyone. We're going to be faced with, you know, different degrees of challenges in our lives. And we have to trust God for that agility to keep moving on and to, you know, overcome the hurdles gracefully without becoming defined by them. And I think that's what was even come through with listening to PDK sharing, because the number of things I would imagine you could share about, and then to hear about the university experience, I'm like, okay, that's great. But to still speak to a few things that stand out, maybe one will be my first childbirth. It was quite an emotionally demanding, almost draining experience. And I do remember that at some point during the labor, that was really long and, you know, it's protracted, is that the word to be used there? Yeah. I remember at some point feeling as though if I could pass out or pass on, then the pain would stop, I would stop feeling that pain. And I remember immediately taking that back and saying, nope, you know, I'm not going to give in to the pain and all that. And then even after having the baby and all the joy and excitement, I still felt like I went through almost a 3 to 6 month period of not being able to navigate just the degree of trauma that I felt, you know, and not knowing if the distressing feelings, the feeling of being alone and needing comfort that I wasn't receiving was normal with someone who had just had a baby. It wasn't clear, you know. Of course, there are many more resources and support groups today that can really help you, you know, get more answers. But I was a first-time mom. I didn't feel like I had the toolkit, you know, to really go through that period excellently. But looking back, I would say that it sort of made me dig in deeper into our relationship with God. It was the only anchor I had, and I utilized it, and that was helpful. But for sure, that was quite a demanding experience that definitely left a mark in my heart and keeps me really tender toward the pregnant people or women who have just had a baby and going through that phase of their lives. A second big challenge would probably be the passing of a very beloved, you know, aburo to me. She was my executive assistant, and she was stabbed coming from work one evening, December 2019, and of course it really made the headlines, even led to a few changes in Lagos's legislation, and I thought that was a blessing from the pain. But I remember feeling the degree of grief that I felt from the experience was not just painful, it was crippling. I remember temporarily losing a zest for life, you know, losing a desire to do anything, had a retreat and just had to leave the country, you know, to sort of come in touch with what I was feeling and spend time to pray, get answers and all of that. People sometimes have expectations that you won't call them out because you're a Christian.